next week. Now, an NBC special presentation, The Jay Leno Show.
Many great documents were written here in Philadelphia. The Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights. Philadelphia is also home to a document far more significant than any of these. A document that's helped us deal with a culture that grows more complicated every day. Of course, I'm talking about TV Guide. With me today is the historian in residence here at TV Guide, Charles Nicholson. Charlie, how'd all this come about?
It's Charles. As you can see, the first TV Guide just listed shows alphabetically. Then the framers of the guide, in a burst of inspiration, began to list shows by day and hour.
Oh, that's interesting. Why do you think that all came about?
Originally, viewers would read the guide to find their favorite shows. The founding viewers at TV Guide realized that Americans don't want to take the time to find their favorite shows. They want to know what's on now.
Oh, I see. Sort of a guide to TV viewing, literally a TV guide.
Exactly, Jay. Unlike the historic documents you mentioned, TV Guide has gone on and grown. Oh, sure, the Constitution has a few amendments on it, but the guide is a flexible document. It varies from region to region. Early evening in New Mexico, for example, you watch The Dating Game. Early evening in Maine, you watch The Newlywed Game.
Kind of real cultural diversity.
Exactly. And our four viewers could not have known about modern technological advancements like daytime programming and cable. But, as you can see, they've made space in the guide to accommodate for them.
Just for the fun of it, do you have the original TV guide around?
Better than that, Jay. We have the prototype. The drafters of the guide were so far-sighted, they had a celebrity issue before we even had celebrities. This is not only a pre-season issue, this is a pre-television issue, back when Americans didn't have televisions.
Well, what do they do?
This old-fashioned thing called reading.
Now get this. Car over bimbo equals ratings. And let me tell you something else. You've got to...
I think you know a document's historically important when it's studied in our major university. These students are part of an accelerated program of intensive study designed to deepen their understanding of TV Guide.
So, all right, Friday, 8 o'clock, NBC, all 84.
That would be Knight Rider.
The September 14th episode. Anybody? Yes.
Kit suffers computer dysfunction and endangers Michael's life.
Very good. Now, who can give me a brief thematic summary of this week's cover story, Rise and Fall of a Sex Symbol? Yes, you.
The theme of the article is that the temporality of physical attraction necessarily undermines one's prime time viability, and that descent into cable is inevitable.
Excellent. All right, now, the plot.
These kids
of the
are
first
studying
Star
hard
Trek
to become episode. Knowledgeable viewers.
The plot
but they won't just
Star
watch
episode.
Alf. They'll watch it with an enriched sense of TV history, well, knowing its roots are in Howdy Doody and Battlestar Galactica. But while reading about TV is important, let's not forget what's really important, and that's watching TV.
Rerun!
A show we've seen before.
Spinoff!
Like a show we've seen before.
Syndication!
A show we've seen before with a different title.
Summer replacement!
A show we'll never see again.
Okay, today's vocabulary! Encore.
Boy, they're good kids.
Infotainment!
Welcome to the Jay Leno Show. With me, Lou Leonard. Jay's guests are Vanna White, Doug Llewellyn, the Hooters, and from the Philadelphia 76ers, Andrew Toney, Perry Moss, Jeff Rulin, and Dr. J, Julius Irving, with a special guest appearance by David Letterman. Our show this time is coming to you from Pier 12 on the Delaware River, directly under the Ben Franklin Bridge in Philadelphia, on an experimental NBC coast-to-coast hookup. Remember, if you don't like this one, there won't be any more. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
And now, please welcome raconteur, bon vivant, and motorcycle aficionado, Jay Leno.
to be here. We flew in about 4 or 5 days ago. There are about, obviously, you see, about 50 people in the crew. So rather than come on a commercial flight, NBC put us on a chartered plane. Save a couple of bucks. You ever fly on a chartered plane? This is like stepping into the hole of some kind of flying slave ship, this thing. No seats, bodies piled on bodies. All the pilots are lined up in the terminal. They're pumping quarters into that insurance machine. One flight attendant for the whole plane. Helga the Stomping Mare was our flight attendant. Kind of a large, burly woman wearing this Mayan death mask. She's handing out this concoction of gruel and bug juice. I mean, the movie was Eraserhead, all right? Just to give you some idea. Now, you know, I don't want to die in a plane. Nobody wants to die on a plane. But if you are going to go down on a plane, you want to go down on American or United or TWA or Eastern. You don't want to go down on a chartered plane. You know, these are the kind of planes, when they do crash, you only hear about it on cable. You know, they come in with a bulldozer, there's some sort of a mass grave, a little headstone. They thought so little of themselves, dot, 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 you know, one of those. You know, what happened to air travel? I mean, it used to be very elegant. You know, you look at the slogans the airlines have. 3 years ago, Delta Airline, their slogan was, Delta, the airline run by professionals. Last year, it went to Delta, we're ready when you are. You know, the new slogan is the actual slogan for this year, Delta, we get you there. So shut up. Sit down. Then they give you that stupid airline safety card. You ever see this thing, the little card they have? And it's all in pictures rather than words, because they figure if you're flying on this thing, you're already illiterate, you know. They show you what to do in the event of a water landing, you know, in case the plane lands on the water, you know. This thing doesn't careen into the sea upside down on fire 60,000 feet a second. Just kind of lands on the ocean, gently kisses the shore, you know. They give you the impression like, oh, cover those drinks. You don't want to spill that ice during that crash. Then they show you how to get into the emergency life raft. I mean, it's a joke. It's a joke. They have a guy. He's got 1 foot in the drawing on the life raft. He's got the other foot on the wing of the plane, and he's helping a young lady in skirt and heels into the lifeboat. This guy would grind his heel into her face to get out of that plane. Look out, sweetheart, I'm out of here. Get that damn baby out of the aisle. You can't get a guy to hold the door of the supermarket unless you're getting out of a burning airplane. And of course, she's real bright. In the photo, she's got spiked heels stepping into an inflatable life raft. You know, the two of them. Then the last shot, they always have the guy on the flotation cushion, you know. And in the drawing, the plane is always parked on the water off to the side. You know, it's never going down for the third time. It's always parked. And the guy just floating. He's got that look on his face like, gee, I guess we'll be about an hour late getting to Kennedy there. I better cancel those dinner reservations. Yeah. You know, now I'm not putting down NBC. It's not that the flight was so bad. It's just that it makes stops. You know, charters make so many stops. Not even regular stops. Just the kind of stops so, like, the pilot can show the plane to his friends. You know what I'm talking about? We changed planes in Atlanta. True story. I'm walking through the Atlanta airport. The guy's got a little booth set up. He's handing out free samples of these soft cookies. You know these soft cookies, everybody's gotten them. The guy gives me one, I eat it, I don't think anything about it. Then I get on my connecting flight and I realize, this is unbelievable. Here I am traveling all across the United States, I land in a strange city, a man I don't really know hands me something and I eat it! I mean, I didn't even look at it, it's gonna be some kind of PLO cookie bomb, I don't know what this is. I go to my mom's house for Christmas, she bakes stuff, I won't even try. You know, it's amazing how you drop your guard. You ever walk into your local supermarket around holiday time, their little TV tray sitting there, 30 or 40 gooey cheese balls under a hot light, they've been there 18, 19 hours. There's nobody around, you get your little toothpick, you eat a couple, you don't even think about it. Yet you walk down the medicine aisle, oh, there's poor Tylenol in a steel box and a metal crate with safety tape around it, you know, a couple of armed guards are watching this thing, boy. You know, there's something real suspicious about this whole soft cookie phenomenon. I mean, fresh cookies are soft, stale cookies are hard. We now live in an age of technology where these giant corporations are now able to make stale, soft cookies. You know, these are old cookies. Somebody went back and put soft stuff in. Come on, look. These big companies, what are we talking about? Parisian bakers here? These dedicated little guys getting up every day baking? Come on, this is a big business. They see somebody else with a soft cookie. Well, we need one too. Anybody got any ideas we can get a soft cookie? Gee, I got an idea, boss. Why don't we use only the finest ingredients and bake them fresh every day? Who is that guy? Get the hell out of here. Who is that guy? Harrington, you call the chemical company. See if they got a soft name so we can put in these cookies there. Johnson, you call the Metamucil people. See what they put in their product. Oh, boy. Well, we've got a terrific show for you tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Now, I want to tell you, it's going to be a fast-paced show. But for those of you a lot of it won't be apparent to the naked eye. Now, let me explain what I'm saying here. So if you have a VCR, videotape recorder, put a tape in now. Put a tape in now, because things happen so quickly, you might want to go back and take a look at some of this stuff. So don't be afraid to kind of erase that old Airwolf or Manimal episode you haven't seen yet, okay? So let's go into the audience and see how you folks doing, okay? All right? This is what Philadelphia people look like, ladies and gentlemen. You know, there are many fine institutions here in Philadelphia, and we went to one of them earlier today. Let's take a look.
A lot of TV has had its origins here in Philadelphia. For example, most people think the People's Court is just a TV show, but there's a municipal court here in Philadelphia that is strikingly similar.
Well, you see, the idea for a courtroom MC really came out of utter confusion. We found that people in the courtroom watching the trials didn't have the foggiest idea of what was going on. I mean, let's face it, if you say this is the case of Roe versus Wade, that doesn't tell you anything at all, right? But if you say this is the case of the defective plummeting parachute, well, now it's a different story, and you can really enjoy the proceedings.
But, Doug, you also work on People's Court.
Yeah, I do a little television on the side. I enjoy it. But my roots are really in legitimate law. TV pays okay, but let's face it. In this historic Philadelphia court, we hear arguments that often set legal precedents. The plaintiff, the state of Pennsylvania, claims that the defendant murdered his entire family simply because they teased him. The defendant, on the other hand, claims that his entire family just tripped and happened to fall on kitchen knives. So join us now for the case of the terrible over-teased teen.
Be seated. Look, I don't know why I didn't get the job. I have a saxophonist. I refer to my bailiff, Happy, by his nickname, Happy the Bailiff, Rusty the Bailiff. See what I mean? I also use a court MC, who also happens to be Doug Llewellyn.
The plaintiff, a creationist, claims that man was created by God. The defendant, an evolutionist, claims that man is descended from the apes. Join us now for the case of the mischievous missing link.
I've read your depositions. This is a very weighty matter. Now, why are you asking this court to decide on the origins of man?
Because her pet monkey threw a ball through my window and she won't pay.
Why should I? Man is descended from monkey, so that makes him a man. Make the monkey pay.
Man was descended from God.
Was not.
Was to.
Was not.
Was to.
You've got to be kidding. You're not going to go over again. That's incredible that you would say such a thing. You are just
a lot like the ones on People's Court. Fascinating case, Doug.
Well, Jay, it's all because of the way it was presented. I mean, using innovations in courtroom procedure developed right here in Philadelphia.
Boy, it sure makes watching law fun.
I agree, it does. I'll let you in on a little secret. Judge Kirkland is right now developing a new series for prime time involving prime time crime, like armed robbery, murder, assault, that kind of stuff.
Boy, that sounds like even more fun. I mean, how's that going to work?
Well, we're doing a pilot trial inside right now. Would you like to take a look?
Oh, boy, would I.
Well, come on. I'll let you have a seat. Now, Miss Grimes, I want you to take your time. Think very carefully. Please be precise, because the answer you're about to give is very important. Now, the defendant said that on the night of the murder, he was at a party. And you said, at a party!
Law and laughter, they go hand in hand.
Show an awful lot, and David has given so many people their start in comedy. I thought to return the favor, I'd like to give Dave his start in drama. So won't you welcome tonight, making his dramatic debut, Mr. David Letterman, ladies and gentlemen. Great. This is great. This isn't too embarrassing, huh? My first show, someone shoots Letterman. Great. I don't know. No, he's dead. You know, maybe I should have said something about the letter and the death threat.
What death threat letter?
We got a letter from some guy who wanted to read it on the air how he was going to kill Letterman, but I didn't want to read it because I didn't want to do viewer mail. Dave does viewer mail on his show. I don't know. You know, I don't know whether we should go on with this show or something. Listen, those of you that are taping it, play the tape back slowly tonight. Play it back slowly, and I think you'll find the hidden clues that maybe help us figure out who the culprit is.
Should they play it back now?
No. I think the show must go on, because really, I think that's what Dave would have wanted. You know, he said right backstage, not 20 minutes ago.
Look, Jay, do me a favor. If anything should happen to me, stop the show immediately.
He was quite a guy, Miss Leonard. What's the next piece?
David's dramatic debut in the Glass Menagerie.
We can't do that. He's dead.
Oh, David shows a clip from his upcoming...
We can't show the clip. He's dead. Don't you understand?
Well, you and David ad-lib.
We can ad-lib. Don't you understand? He's a stiff. We're getting him out of
you
here.
You in the audience.
Oh, in the audience. Oh, okay, great. Come on, let's talk to some of the people and see what we get here. Now, how do you folks feel about gun control?
I have no opinion.
No opinion on gun control, yeah. How about you, sir? Any opinion?
Yeah, I think everyone should be allowed to carry a gun.
Hey, wait a minute. Sis. Ladies and gentlemen, you know what this is? This is a W. Yeah. This could be part of a clue. Yeah. Yeah, that's it. A scrambled word, a puzzle, an anagram. This could be the key to the culprit's identity. We've got to collect every one of these letters, and when you're dealing with letters, you need the help of a professional. Vanna? Is Vanna White, ladies and gentlemen. Vanna? Hang this letter on the paper. Hey, wait a minute. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a young lady in the audience. She looks like she's crying. Hey, what's the matter? Are you upset about the murder of David Letterman?
Yes.
Oh, she's pretty upset. Would some gum and candy help, huh? Come on, look, some gum and candy. Wait a minute. Some more gum and candy, is that okay, huh? There's a big smile. Okay, it's not so bad, is it? Run around with it where you're parking. Now, anybody got a baby on board sign on the car? Anybody have one? Nobody in this whole... Someone is lying. All right, we'll take a look at this. Okay.
If you're like me, you appreciate motorists who are responsible enough to place a baby on board sign on their car. This innovation never fails to jolt me back a safe distance just at the very moment I'm about to tailgate, exceed the extremely fair 55-mile-an-hour speed limit, or maybe perform an unnecessary wheelie. Now, it says baby on board, but...
I don't see a little tight down there anywhere. He's probably rolled under the seat. It's an awful hot day, and these windows are airtight. Every second counts. If only there was something... Hey, this'll be great.
Fortunately, this car is empty. You know, I've never been happier to be wrong about something in my life. Oh, sure, that was a false alarm, but it's better to be safe than sorry.
Traditionally, big business has always gotten a bad rap on TV, so my next guest has asked for equal time. Here is businessman Marv Costas.
Thanks, Jay. You know, this past year has been a good one for big business, but we've had our share of embarrassing moments, too. So we thought we'd put some of them on tape, sort of a gag reel, and let people see the warm, human side of the American businessman. Okay, let's go to the videotape. Now, here's an oil company that felt steel tankers were a little pricey, so they came up with this baby, an aluminum tanker with a plywood-reinforced hull. Sure, it's cheap, but hit a floating log and, uh-oh, oil slick. Major blooper. Hey, you'll need more than a handy wipe for that mess. That bird looks about a quart low. Better throw it back in. Now, here's a company laid great track. Tested it for snow, ice, rain, but not a copperhead penny. Ouch, that hurts. No passengers, but that cloud is nerve gas. If there was a roach problem in town, it's gone now. Now talk about a mistake. Kenton Power Company donated some of their gaily painted canisters of nuclear waste to a playground. You know how kids love to climb. But kick one of these babies and super blooper! Permanent recess! By the way, Jay, the guys at the Kenton Power Company are this year's winners of the Chernobyl Prize. Share Nobel Prize, get it? For a good idea that backfired in a big way.
Yeah, I guess by pointing out the differences, you hope to make a tragedy seem more like a practical joke.
Well, you know, that's it exactly. Very well put, Jay. I think if we can all see the lighter side of business blunders, there'll be fewer lawsuits, too. And we can free the courts for real criminals.
Yeah, that's great. Okay, Marvin, thanks for coming on the show, Marv.
Thanks,
Marv,
Jay. Foster. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Marv. Eyes. That's interesting. Wait a minute. What's this? This woman has a pair of eyeballs. Wait a minute. Can I have those, please? Can I have those? Two eyes. Two eyes, of course. Vanna, look. Tear these eyes out and put them up in the pegboard.
Yuck.
Boy, it pays to hire the best, doesn't it? The fabulous Vanna White, ladies and gentlemen. Here's a gentleman. Now, sir, how are you? What's your name?
Tom.
Tom, now, thanks for tucking your shirt tail in, sir, I guess. You figured to be on TV, all the relatives you'd see, you'd go that extra mile, I guess, pretty much. Is that your motorcycle? That's your helmet.
Outside.
You rode your bike tonight in the rain?
Yes.
Yeah, what kind of bike?
250 Honda.
250 Honda, so not quite a real bike, sir, actually, but close enough, you know. See, the only thing about riding a motorcycle is, people you don't even know always feel obligated. You get this, they come up to you, and they tell you some horrible motorcycle story that happened to somebody they know. You know, this is a true story. I'm in the market, I got my helmet in my hand. This guy said, hey, you ride a motorcycle? I said, yeah, I do. Yeah, my cousin had one of them things. Drove head-on into a threshing machine with it. Yeah, I got his face sheared off. You won't be shaving for a while. Oh. Well, we're getting... So how about you, sir? What do you do here in town? You what?
I'm speechless.
You're speechless. You're a speechless teacher, in other words. Okay. No, you don't. You have any kind of employment?
Advertising.
Advertising. How's that work? You have your own sandwich board kind of thing, and the hot pants and the roller skate. Oh. Who are some of your clients? Things you would know?
Industrial accounts. Sunday.
Industrial accounts. Dioxin manufacturers, maybe. Someone is eating, ladies and gentlemen. I have no idea. By the way, all right, we all set to roll another piece of tape here. As you know, now, if I'm not mistaken, Philadelphia, the home of the mint. Many people aware of this, yes, very famous mint. Well, we went to the mint, we went there 2 days ago, and here it is. We'll take a look at it.
I'm standing here in front of the famed Philadelphia Historical Mint with curator Larry.
Oh, please, call me Lawrence.
Okay, Lawrence. Can you tell us a little bit about the mint?
Well, we've been making sterling silver and pewter collectibles for 153 years. Many of your viewers may already own the handcrafted chess set or the presidential series. Each president lovingly reproduced in sterling silver.
I see. Now, what brings you out here in the street today?
Well, we're going to unveil some new, more commercial collectibles, which will soon be available to the American consumer.
I see. Such as?
Well, we're all familiar with the tacky I love you this much statue.
Yeah.
Well, our version has been issued in a limited casting of 15,000. Each figurine is solid pewter on a lead base and has been hand-signed by the artist.
That's lovely.
Yeah, we prefer the word cute, Jay. Oh. Next, we have the chattering teeth. Made of genuine ivory, available in gold or silver. Each comes with its own handsome leatherette carrying case. Wind these up, you not only have a funny joke, you'll have a collector's item your family will treasure for generations.
Now, how about here? What is this under here?
Oh, this is the hammered silver I Heart My Dog Head, which has been etched into the silver, then inlaid with gold. This is a real collector's item and a traffic stopper.
I see. Now, what does something like that go for?
$150,000.
It's kind of pricey, isn't it?
Quality doesn't come cheap, Jay.
Ladies and gentlemen, our special guest band playing Day by Day from their platinum album, Philly's Own, The Hooters. And we're back, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, time for my favorite part of the program. This is the part of program we endeavor to prove that Barnum was right, a sucker is born every minute. What's that, cheese brain? You have trouble accepting that. You say in these high-tech times, people are getting more intelligent. Wrong, chuckle face. We bought these books at the same bookstore right here in Philadelphia. The Complete Works of William Shakespeare, $4.95. 100 Uses for a Dead Cat, $6.95. Don't you think Shakespeare would be a little annoyed at this? And how about American workmanship? People say we don't care anymore. We don't build things the way we used to. How about this, knuckle face? Here's the way we used to build things. Here's the Liberty Bell. Look at the crack in that thing. It's been 200 years. We still haven't fixed it. Is that American workmanship? Let's face it, we never knew how to build anything. I went in and bought one of these today, a lovely replica of the Liberty Bell. See this? There's no clapper in it. What's that, Whistlehead? You say you don't buy things like this? You don't like souvenirs. You're not like the rest of us. You're above the crowd. I'll bet you don't even read the tabloids. You probably get all your information from reliable sources. Like what? Maybe the New York Times, perhaps. How about the Wall Street Journal? Well, let's take a look at these two newspapers. June 26, 1986, the New York Times says... U.S. deficit soared in May. Wall Street Journal same day says federal deficit narrowed in May. What's going on there, Chuck? Bought this right here in Philadelphia, a new hair gel. It says it has a memory. You can run wet fingers through your hair and recapture style. Hair gel with a memory. No, my hair's not messy. Maybe it just has amnesia, okay? Here's one for the upwardly mobile cheese. This is a new magazine on the stands, an actual magazine, walking magazine. Just what we need, a magazine that tells you how to walk. If you don't know how to walk, how are you going to buy the magazine? You're going to crawl to the newsstand? Huh? Let's look at some of the articles. These are the real articles in this magazine. Here we are, introducing walking, a healthy alternative. Alternative to what? Astral projection? How about these ads? Oh, here's a shoe that fits your needs. How about a shoe that fits my foot? too much to ask, Toehead? Look at this. You got shoes for the street. You got shoes for walking, shoes for jogging, tennis shoes, running shoes. You can carry them all right here in the handy shoe pack. Gee, you think the reason for publishing this magazine has anything to do with merchandising? Three guesses, yuppie puppy. Hey, what's that, couch potato? Walking doesn't interest you. You want to hear more about the real problems of the world? Let's check the newspapers again. August 13th, 1986, New York Times. House votes more in 87 for Star Wars. Same day, Wall Street Journal. House decides to reduce Star Wars money. Yo, National Enquirer is starting to look pretty unimpeachable, isn't it, Piltdown Man, huh? Maybe you want a compact disc player and you want the latest by Twisted Sister. Yes, Twisted Sister, available on compact disc. Are they really doing some subtle musical nuance that I'm missing somehow, huh? When these guys scream, burn in hell, do I really miss it, playing it on my old hi-fi? Is that, you know, in fact, if you play burn in hell backwards, you hear the secret message, go to church, pray with your family. Thank you very much. We're out of here. Let's roll, Lou! When David went down, a lot of Philadelphia's talented actors stepped forward to help out. We'd love to have them all on the show, but unfortunately, as big a star as David was, there was only one role open. So finally, in a scene from The Glass Menagerie, in the role of Amanda, is our own Miss Lou Leonard. And making his dramatic debut from the Philadelphia 76ers, Andrew Tony as Floyd. And Harry Moss as Floyd. And Jeff Ruland as Floyd. And in the role of Floyd, Dr. J, Julius Erving.
Laura's gentleman caller. I'm her mama. She'll be along in a moment. She had to finish windexing her glass menagerie. Oh, what did she say your name was?
Floyd Grayson.
Oh, Charmin. Oh, you can always tell the character of a man by his handshake. Oh, won't you sit down? Oh, how about a cookie?
Thank you, ma'am. This is a very good cookie.
Oh, I remember my first gentleman caller. He took me to the July 4th cotillion. He waltzed me out into the veranda. There was a full moon and magnolia blossom everywhere. Then suddenly, I felt his arms strong about me. But sir, I said, I scarcely know you. No, no, you mustn't.
Nightclubs, movie theaters. What's it like to be single in Philadelphia? Let's check it out. Saturday night is not fun for all Philadelphians. A lot of Philadelphians, it's work. Just meeting the right people requires more than just going out and hanging around. A lot of scientific thought goes into the process. Clarity and sobriety are one of the most important. Let's talk to some of the young people here at Elan. This is a private club here in Philadelphia. What kind of work do you do in Philadelphia?
Well, I'm an entertainer.
You're an entertainer? What kind of entertainer?
I'm a singer, a professional singer. And I'm also in the insurance business, believe it or not.
Oh, I see. So you're just singing and recording until you can get a full-time insurance position.
There you go.
I see. Now, do you meet many women here?
Yes, I've met a lot of nice women here.
Really? Mm-hmm. Really? How often do you meet women here?
Every night.
Every night?
That's right.
You meet a woman every night?
New women, many women.
You meet many women here?
One or two. I don't like to brag. But.
You don't like to brag, sir, but since you have the chance, you might as well. Do you meet many women here?
Plenty.
You meet many women here?
Yeah.
You ever met a woman here that actually turned into anything?
It depends what you mean by anything.
I mean, some sort of reasonable relationship that two humans would have.
Yes.
Have you ever met a guy in this place?
No.
No. No.
You think you'll meet a guy from here someday?
Probably not. Never, never, never.
So you're a waitress here at the club. Have you ever seen people actually meet here?
No. No, I haven't.
You never seen couples meet here and go home together?
No.
No, never happened. How long have you been working here?
5 years.
5 years. No one has ever met anyone. And you're the bartender?
Yes, I have. 6 years.
Been here 6 years. Now, apparently, this seems to be a pretty successful dating bar. Have you seen many couples go home together?
Never, not even once. A couple people got close, but before they got to the door, they met other people, and things happened. They never went home.
So no one has ever actually met anyone from here?
No, as far as I know, never once.
Not even once. You're a lawyer and attorney. What kind of law?
Divorce law. You might say I'm the kind of resident divorce lawyer here.
You're the resident divorce lawyer here. So I imagine for someone like you, this must be a virtual field day, sir.
Well, it is a kind of emotional accident scene here.
Yeah, yeah.
And as a matter of fact, as your camera swings round inadvertently, there might be a lot of women in my office tomorrow asking about...
Oh, really? So you come here and try to...
It's a kind of emotional slip and fall place.
Oh, I see. So you mean...
You don't see it happen.
No.
But it's happening psycho-emotionally.
Oh, I see. Now, do you ever meet any women here?
Occasionally.
Are you married yourself?
No.
Are you divorced?
Yes.
The single life. Not for the squeamish.
Everybody knows American Bandstand started here in Philadelphia. Anybody know the address of the studio? No, 46th and Market is where is the address of the studio. Anybody know why American Bandstand left Philadelphia? Anybody know why?
They didn't like their uniforms.
They didn't like their uniforms. Yeah, real. She got it, boy. First try. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we did kind of an investigative piece. We went down to 46th and Market. We, like many other Americans, were concerned as to why American Bandstand left Philadelphia. And, well, this is kind of a 60 Minutes kind of piece, so hopefully this will clear it up for a lot of you. Let's take a look at that. There used to be a show here in Philadelphia, a fine show. In fact, you might say it was an institution. Then about 20 years ago, it just disappeared. Why? We're going to spend the next 3.5 hours trying to find out. This is where it all began, and this is where it ended. Amera and Banton. No, that can't be right. Oh, American Bandstand. Some of the letters probably fell off. Come on, let's take a look inside and see what we can find. Probably nothing in there anyway. You know, the real action was next door. This is where the kids would hang out, maybe have a hamburger or a malted, and they talk about the theme of American Bandstand. Come on, let's see if any of the old-timers are still around, and maybe they can kind of cue us in a little bit on... Teenagers, what do they know, huh? Probably couldn't tell you anything anyway. Probably would have forgotten everything by that point. Come on, let's see. They probably opened up now. We can take a look inside. Almost as interesting as American Bandstand is Dick Clark himself. But who is this enigma the world calls Dick Clark? Let's find out. Let's talk to some people who knew Richard, a.k.a. Dick Clark. Have a seat, sir. Now, you were present the very last show American Bandstand did in Philadelphia?
Yeah, I was there.
You were there?
Yeah, I said I was.
Now, didn't I hear you say to someone before you weren't there?
I said I was.
You can't have it both ways, sir. Were you there or not?
I was there on the last night.
Well, we happen to have some footage, sir, of the very last night filmed in Philadelphia. Let's take a look at it. Now, sir, I don't see anyone in this crowd that even remotely resembles you, do you?
No, I don't.
Well, you're not visible in the crowd. What does that say to you, sir?
I don't know. Maybe I wasn't on the camera. Maybe this is a different film.
That's highly unlikely, sir. Maybe you're not telling the truth.
I was there. That's where I met my wife.
We're talking with the alleged spouse. Now, you claim to be his wife.
Yes.
Now, can you prove it?
No, but I can tell you why Clark left town.
That's a little off track, but okay, go ahead.
Well, we have this thing here called the Philadelphia Sound, you know. The kids like to dance to it. And then this enigmatic Clark guy brings in music from foreign places like Liverpool and California. The Beatles, Dylan, Hendrix. You couldn't dance to it if you tried. See?
Yeah, it looks horrible. We went to Clark's Philadelphia home to find out more about this enigmatic man shrouded in mystery. This is the old Clark Mansion, handed down for generations, built before the advent of indoor plumbing. It was nonetheless home for the increasingly enigmatic Clark. What else do we know about Dick Clark? Well, we've unearthed some interesting and revealing information. For example, Dick Clark is not his name. His real name is Richard. Well, why did he change it? What was he trying to hide? I'm talking with John. John, what do you do here in Philadelphia?
I make corned beef.
You make corned beef. Any idea why American Bandstand left Philadelphia?
Hey, I want to continue to make corned beef in this town.
I wasn't aware it left.
I'd rather not say.
I'm afraid for my dog. I'd rather not speak. I have no idea.
I'm getting married soon. I'd rather not speak.
Look, you have to go back to California. I have to live here.
A town gripped by fear. I'm with Mr. and Mrs. Earl Dumas. Now, you were present the last night American Bandstand was on in Philadelphia?
The last? No, the first night. We were at the first American Bandstand.
Yes, I remember. We had just learned to do the locomotion. Oh, I still love that show.
So you still watch it?
Yeah, the one from L.A. there. The one his grandson hosts.
No, that's him. That's Dick Clark.
You mean Dick Clark Jr.?
No, that's Dick Clark.
It can't be. He was older than us when we were on the show.
Oh, it's him. It's him. Oh,
it's all right, Tootsie. You'll have to leave now, Mr. Limo. She's getting hysterical.
So we find ourselves back where we began, enigmatizing a riddle wrapped in a mystery. Here in a rundown studio where nothing is left of American Bandstand except some memories and stock footage of kids dancing. And enigmas. Why did American Bandstand leave Philly? That answer will go with Dick Clark to his grave, which at this rate could take hundreds of years.
Bacon, lettuce, and tomato.
Bacon, lettuce, and tomato. Hey, that's sometimes called a BLT, isn't it, sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, Vanna. More clues. Let's see. Wait a minute. Excuse me. L for lettuce. T for tomato. Where's the bacon, sir?
I ate it.
Oh, great. This is what happens when you try to conduct a criminal investigation with amateurs. Look, put these on the pegboard, Vanna. Yeah. Okay. See what we got. W, I, L for lettuce, T for tomato. Will. Will Chamberlain. Yeah, Will Chamberlain used to play basketball here in Philadelphia, didn't he? Yeah? Yeah, sure he did. That's it. Wait a minute. Vanna, you think Will Chamberlain could have killed Letterman?
There aren't enough spaces for Chamberlain.
All right, wait a minute. You know, by the way, isn't that a beautiful dress that Vanna has on tonight? Can we get a beautiful dress?
It's only a V-neck, Jay.
What? I'm sorry, what'd you say, Vanna?
It's only a V-neck.
A V-neck. It is a V-neck. Wait a minute. V-neck. V. That's a clue. V. Vanna, hang that dress on the pegboard right now. V for Vanna.
Yes, really.
All right. Lou, you make up a V or something. Just put it up there, all right?
You know, our lives are good, and they seem to be getting better all the time. Right now, we're going to talk to the director of the Philadelphia Organ Transplant Institute, Dr. Elizabeth Williams. Hello, doctor. Now, Doctor, I understand there's been some major breakthroughs at the Institute.
That's right, Jay. And yes, we are on the verge of something very exciting. A truly portable artificial heart.
Let's take a look.
Sure, you can make a living practicing traditional health care, but the big dough is in replacement parts. Livers, kidneys, lungs, and limbs. And of course, the big one. The key to financial freedom, the artificial heart. Yes, this is the frisbee of modern medicine. And you get a portable artificial heart to work, and you've got a virtual license to print cash. Now, this patient here is being kept alive by the old-fashioned stationary heart you see in the background. Let's take him off that and put him on the heart that I designed. This is a gas-powered, 2-horsepower engine you carry with you on your back.
Very impressive.
Yes, this tube here regulates the blood supply. It plugs right into the left ventricle.
I see, kind of like a vacuum cleaner connection.
Very similar. As you see, we've designed this so the layperson can operate it easily.
He doesn't look too good there.
Well, he's off the old heart, and the new one hasn't started yet.
What about oxygen? Shouldn't
that
have...
That oxygen thing is an old wives' tale, Jay. We have several minutes before any real brain damage occurs. The motor's cold. These things can be very tricky. It should start right up. One. There we go.
Kind of noisy in the dark.
That's just exhaust from the motor. Now, the thing is, Jay, preventative medicine will soon be a thing of the past, a mere superstition. No more restricting your lifestyle just because you're afraid of a little organ failure.
And you get a little too much gas in the dark?
Yes, but that can happen with a real heart. With this one, you can control it.
Well, I guess he'll have to watch his diet from now on.
But for he's already wrecked his real heart, this one's made of steel.
Really? You mean no more dieting or jogging or all that?
Right, Jay. And with this heart here, you can eat anything, even the heaviest Italian food. As you can see here, all we do is adjust the throttle, get the heart up to speed, set it for heavy food. Yes, this is designed to stand the load you like to carry.
It looks kind of messy, Doc.
That's a small price to pay for the freedom to live, Jay.
And this thing really works, huh?
Yes, it's a great moment in medicine.
How is the patient doing?
Oh, he's dead, Jay. He left the heart running overnight in a closed room and died of carbon monoxide poisoning.
Yeah, great. Well, listen, Doc, thanks for coming on the show. Gee, it's always nice to have scientists on who are helping us to improve our daily lives. Thank you, Doctor.
Here's a guy over here. How about you? And thanks for putting on a clean T-shirt to come to the show. So, what do you do?
I'm an antique dealer.
An antique dealer, just turning out new antiques every day, I imagine.
Downstairs.
I see a lot of you might enjoy this Tarzan patio furniture you're sitting on here. This is kind of interesting. Look, will you get this thing out of here, please? Oh, boy. Let me see where we are. Are we almost all set here for our next endeavor? Yes, how do you do? Here's what I always wanted to do. They always do this in 60 minutes. Hey. No. What? Why do people even talk to Mike Wallace? Do you ever wonder about that? I mean, you're sitting in your house, you look out your front door, there's a CBS field generator out there, 6 trucks, Mike Wallace got a portfolio this thick with your name, get the hell out of there. These guys always figure, oh, he got nothing on me. How about this gentleman, what do you do, sir?
I work in a supermarket.
You work in a supermarket, you're in marketing. Yeah, that... I find you score better if you say you're in marketing. How about this young lady, what do you do? You work in a supermarket, oh, same one? Oh, you all work in the market, so there's somebody
in the 10-item line real teed off right about now.
You about ready to roll here?
Have a lot of gamblers here in the crowd?
Yes, sir.
I think you might find this next piece of interest.
There's one thing Philadelphians love to do, it's travel. For many, it could be a weekend in Camden or a drive to Cherry Hill, New Jersey. For others, it's that once-in-a-lifetime trip to Atlantic City, New Jersey, the gambling capital of Atlantic City, strange enough. This is where the Atlantic City buses stop at this gaily colored bus here sign. As you can see, the casinos have spent unlimited funds to dress it up with the lights and all the fancy paintwork. And, oh, here comes the bus now. Welcome to the Atlantic City bus, ladies and gentlemen. This is kind of a rolling Ellis Island, you might say. Talking to people, just going to Atlantic City today?
Alcatraz today.
How are you?
Pretty good.
Nice to see you. Going out and do some gambling?
Yeah, a little bit, not much.
A little bit of gambling. Win a few, lose a few.
Right.
How are you? Good to see you. Going to do some winning today, sir?
Yeah, hopefully.
Hopefully do some winning. Boy, you can just read the excitement on these people's faces as they go down for that dream once-in-a-lifetime chance of hitting that big $60 or $70 jackpot on one of the slot machines down there in Atlantic City. And here's a young man. How are you, sir?
Pretty okay.
Going down to Atlantic City, do some gambling?
Win about $500 every time.
You spend $500 every time.
And
win every time. I guess that's why you're taking the bus, sir. Okay, nice to see you. Going down to do some winning today?
Hope to win some big bucks.
Okay, young lady. How are you, sir? Now, what is this you have here? This is the renter's guide?
Yeah.
Are you going down to Atlantic City to do some renting? That would be your ticket, sir.
Yeah.
No, you don't have to show it to me. I think you need to show it to the man in the bus.
Any second now, this door is going to close and these people be off on a vacation of a lifetime. I wish I could be with them, but unfortunately, I've got to go back to California. So long. Goodbye, Tin Man Lion. And now, a woman's place with Lou Leonard.
Last week, I received a letter from a woman in Missouri who writes, "Last month, my car developed a weird pinging noise. I took it to a mechanic, and he told me it needed a valve job. It cost me nearly $1,000. Then I found out what the noise came from. It was using a cheap brand of gas. What is a gal to do? It got ripped off. And there's no need for it if you'll take time to learn about cars. Today, let's take a look at a valve job. Once you remove the engine from the car, remove the cylinder head and place it on a clean surface. Now, take out the valve guides and scrape off the carbon deposits. Look for scoring around the valve guides. If they're worn, you may want to bronze them. They'll get less wear. While we're in here, we also want to inspect the pistons, rings, and connecting rods. By the way, save the old rubber O-rings from the oil filters. They make great cap liners for mason jars. Oh, defective bearings should never be reamed, shimmed, or fitted in any way. Replace them. A quality job here means a quality engine. It takes about an hour to get the engine reassembled. Just put all the parts back where they came from, and you'll have a beautiful retooled engine ready to pop in your car. Now, for cleaning up after engine work, I like to use gentle soap with just a touch of pumice. It strips off the grime, and it leaves a nice scent that he'll appreciate.
Oh, Lou, dinner's ready.
Oh, thanks. Well, gals, that's it for this week. Till next time, remember, a woman's place is every place. Backed by popular demand, the Hooters.
Never say, but it's so dirty and hot. I gotta keep on pushing.
Critics come in tag team these days, much like professional wrestlers. Siskel and Ebert, Lyons and Medved, Reed and Harris. Philadelphia has put a new wrinkle on this trend, the first husband and wife team, and we thought it'd be fun to have them on the show. Please welcome Ned and Sandra Nelson. Let me ask you, what made you two decide to team up and become critics?
Well, Jay, we don't know a lot about entertainment, but we sure as heck know how to argue.
I disagree, Ned.
Sure you do, honey, sure you do.
So tell me, what are the new exciting shows to watch?
I'm glad you asked me that, Jay, because I think the Jay Leno Show is a breath of fresh air in the vast wasteland of network pablum. It's got everything, probing satire, gentle wit.
I disagree, Ned. I won't deny that Mr. Leno has a certain primitive charm, but there are serious lapses in taste.
Wives, huh?
Taste, Sandra, is a very subjective thing. What you might call disgusting, I might call humorous and heartwarming.
Your taste's in your mouth, Ned. The murder of the guest star, tasteful, no. Not only is it violence, it is senseless violence.
Sensible violence, Sandra, sensible violence. I think it gives an edge of gritty realism to an airy barrage of comic invention.
What the hell does that mean, Ned? And what are we doing on the show?
Jay said this would be fun, Sandra. We are fun.
We are not fun. We're not performers. We're not comics. We're not even musicians. Our critics, entertainers now. What's next? Critics who criticize critics?
Well, isn't that exactly what you're doing, Sandra? Criticizing a critic, namely me? Huh? Touché, Sandra. Touché. Chalk one up for me.
You're so stupid. It's frightening.
Now, listen, I'd like to thank you both for being on the show.
What an empty showbiz cliche. You welcome the guests do their little routine, you thank the guests. It's hackneyed, it's trite, it's old. Isn't there any originality left in the world? Can't you think of a creative way to get rid of your guests?
Wow! What a roller coaster ride of excitement this critic has ridden tonight. This show has had everything. Grade A performances, visual excitement, left this reviewer breathless.
Oh, great, not again. Look, I'm getting fed up with the... Where's the... Roll something, will you? Just roll something. Oh, this is great. As a kid, I always loved a good story, and a storyteller isn't something you see much of anymore, so I thought it'd be kind of neat to have one on the show. So sit back, turn down the lights. Here's Ken Nordine.
She had the same dream every night. She was walking at twilight down a deserted country road. It was strangely quiet. No birds sang, no crickets, no frogs. Even the trees were still, the leaves motionless. In her dream, she rounded a bend in the road. There, nestled between two high oak trees, was a small cottage. Somehow, she knew this cottage was her final destination. She stood at the fence and watched the curl of smoke rise from the chimneys. There was nothing here to be afraid of. So why was she so afraid? As if in answer to this unspoken question, the attic window would slowly open, and there, framed against the darkness within, a man's face would appear. An old man's face, pale, long, deep sunken eyes like holes. Then the old man would step back into the shadows within, and she would awaken. The dream ended the same way every night. The dream was all she could think of. It was with her all the time. She needed to get away. She thought of a place that she'd been to in the country, an inn. Yes, a weekend in the country, that's what she needed. And so she found herself at twilight, driving down an abandoned country road. She had missed her turnoff. She was lost. She was driving one-handed, trying to unfold the map. That's when she drove into the tree. She looked up in shock to see the spider web of cracks that her head had made in the windshield. She climbed shakily out of the car and suddenly realized this was the road of her dreams. It was sunset. There was the same eerie silence, the total absence of noise and motion. She began to walk. She rounded the bend, and there was the cottage, the whisk of smoke rising from the chimney. And there she stood by the gate, her head slowly clearing. The attic window slowly opened, and there was the man's face staring at her. Only this was no dream, she thought. This was real. She was here at last. The old man vanished from the window. She walked through the gate, up the path to the front door. She knocked. There was silence. She knocked again. No reply. Please let me in, she said. The door opened suddenly, and the old man was standing there. She stood back a step, and they stared at each other. What is this place, she whispered. Who are you? I live here, he said. Nobody else will live here. Why not, she asked. Because it's haunted, he said.
Haunted? Haunted by what?
It's haunted by you.
Ken Nordine.
If there are any other clues at all, any clue that... Now, wait a minute. It's a long shot. It's a one in a million. Any clues, any... Vanna, say any slowly. What do you get?
N-E.
N-E. N-E. Put an N-E up there. Wait a minute. Here. Put one of these I's up there. Okay, wait, let's go over it. W-I, L for lettuce, T for tomato, V-I-N-E. Wiltvine. There you go. Wiltvine. No, it doesn't mean anything, is it? It's an anagram. It's a puzzle. You got to unscramble it to find the killer. Look, you're the puzzle expert, Vanna. What does it mean?
Jay, I've been on Wheel of Fortune for years, and I still can't figure this one out.
Oh, don't worry, Jay. The people at home have the murderer on tape.
No, I'm not leaving it up to strangers. This show isn't going to end until we find Letterman's killer. What? We're out of time. Oh. Good night, everybody.
Hi, I'm Bob Costas for NBC Sports. For an inside look at the NFL, join Ahmad Rashad, Frank DeFord, Paul McGuire, and me on NFL 86, tomorrow on NBC.
And tomorrow night, Jacqueline Smith, Ken Howard, Angela Lansbury, and Michael Noory are caught in a deadly game of deception. In an all-new Rage of Angels, the story continues. It's an NBC miniseries premiere, tomorrow night.